Need to connect.
All right, we are live.
Hi everyone! Welcome tonight. We are going to talk about cutting the crap. And my name is Dr. Chris Sargent. Most of you know me. And I want to talk about functional medicine first. I want to talk about a little bit about my journey and then make sure that I make good on the promises that I put out there to bring more energy to your life and bring some solutions to some of the problems that we all face in our world, digestive, hormonal, energy issues. All of those things are pretty common, and you know, like, why? How does that happen? How do we end up there? So we're going to talk about that tonight. First, a little bit about me. I've practiced as a chiropractor and functional medicine practitioner for 25 years, which seems like it's been 5 years in one at one moment and 35 at another moment. But I really found a passion for functional medicine probably about 10 years ago, and it's taken me, you know, it's always a journey, right, to get to the place where I just get to do what I wanted to do. And I've also started writing a book 3 different times, and I finally finished it in August.
Yay!
And I know. And that's really what the crap is about, because I wanted to the most common thing that people come to me and tell me is, I feel like crap. And I know that some of you that are here tonight have told me, I feel like crap. And I wanted to be able to say, you know, you don't have to feel like crap, and crap doesn't have to be mean crap. It can mean something else. And so we're going to talk about all the things that crap means to me now and what it's going to mean in the book. The next thing that patients tell me is, I'm pretty sure I'm crazy because my doctor says there's nothing wrong with me. And I'm here to tell you that crap, you're not crazy. You do know more than your doctor. You live in your body all the time. You know your body. And you should be respected, not demeaned or diminished, for what you're feeling and thinking about what's happening inside yourself. Those are not appropriate avenues for a doctor to ever go down, is to demean a patient or make them feel dismissed. When I was 8, I went to a medical doctor with strep throat. And my mom took me to our regular medical doctor. Even though she saw a chiropractor, we still had this balance in our house. And he basically looked at me and said, you know, if you keep gaining weight, you're gonna be 300 pounds by the time you're 19. Now, I'm 8, and I have a sore throat, and I don't feel good, and I'm a kid. And at that very moment, I burst into tears and decided, like, Mom, you can't ever bring me back there. I mean, that's just, it wasn't okay. And I did everything I could to never be sick again. Even if I was, I just went to school and did it anyway because I never wanted to see that doctor again. And I came out of that experience realizing that I was going to change, I wanted to change medicine. Well, when I really looked at going to medical school, I realized that I really wasn't going to be able to do what I wanted to do. And so I went to chiropractic school, not really understanding the beef that people have with chiropractors, which isn't so much anymore, but the, oh, you're a chiropractor. That doesn't happen as much. And now people understand that chiropractors have always done functional medicine. We've always had this philosophy that your body can heal itself, that the patient comes first, and being patient-centered and problem-focused, not diagnosis-focused, not disease-focused, creates a different kind of relationship with patients. And so that's why I ended up in chiropractic school, because I knew I would get that kind of education to treat the patient as a whole, not as this disease or that disease with this specialty and that specialty. Now, that being said, here's my disclaimer. There's a really good place for all medical doctors in all specialties, and they're necessary for a lot of different reasons. We need them. And I'd love to see lifestyle, eat, drink, move, sleep, think, and feel, come before most of that medicine, if at all possible. And so that's what I'm here to do with crap, and introducing, tonight will be one of the first introductions to my DIYFM, which is called Do-It-Yourself Functional Medicine, which isn't what we do here in the office, because you have me. But in order for me to bring functional medicine to the masses, we had to make it simplified and in a do-it-yourself kind of model. And so I've created that inside my book under the A piece, which is action. So I'm pretty, that is like really exciting to me to be able to bring it to that mom out there who can't get here, who can't see me, who can't afford to come here, or who I'd rather have them spend money on supplements and good food instead of coming to see me if they can get this far down the road without seeing me, right? So that's what we're going to talk about tonight. So functional medicine is really about function of the body and how the body systems all function together. You know, if I was to ask you, which body part do you want to get rid of today? Like, which one can you, which, like, do you want to do without your pancreas today? Do you want to do without your brain today? Well, maybe some days. You know, do you want to do without your colon? Like, those are not body parts. That all of those body parts interact and intersect with each other on all kinds of levels. And knowing that means that we have to address the body in that way. You go to your gastroenterologist and he just looks at your, you know, mouth to anus, right? That's all he's looking at. But he's missing the fact that your pancreas is also shooting enzymes in there, and your gallbladder shoots bile in there. And so how's the digestion actually happening? You know, I've had gastroenterologists tell patients that what they eat really has nothing to do with their digestion. Huh? It's like saying, you know, you don't really need gas in your car because it'll just go anyway. It's ludicrous. So, and there are some good gastroenterologists out there. All that to say is that functional medicine really looks at your body as a whole and then treats it to function. Not treating symptoms, but looking at symptoms as a manifestation of some dysfunction inside the body. So if you're not creating energy well, we need to look at some things. What's preventing you from creating energy? Are you not getting the nutrients that you need? If the nutrients are getting in, are they going to the right place? Are they getting all the way into the cell so that they can be used? Are they in a good form? Are they coming in little bits here and there, or are they coming in as one meal at the end of the day? Those are not really sustainable. The body can't really sustain itself in that way. So when and where is the energy coming in, and how is that processed through your system? We call that assimilation. And assimilation is one of the functions that we really look at. There are 7 basic functions. We look at transportation. That's your cardiovascular system. We look at communication. All the cells have to communicate with each other. Neurotransmitters, right? You know what they are, right? The brain chemistry that you make more of in your gut than your brain. Your hormone system, that's also part of the communication system, right? Bio transformation and elimination. Big words for what the liver and the kidneys do. They take all the toxins, because you think that you wash your food and everything and there's nothing on there, right? But you eat a mouthful of bacteria and toxins every time you eat, whether you want to think about it or not. As clean as you're eating, it's still there. And so we have to have this waste system that takes all that toxic stuff and puts it into a form that our body can get rid of. And that's what happens in our detoxification biotransformations function. When those functions start to break down, we get symptoms. When those functions break down, we get symptoms. We can't make energy well. Our skin, hair, nails starts to break down. That's our structural integrity. That's another function of the body. We have to have structure. We have to have good structure. And we get that from the assimilation piece. Right? So all of these functions work together. And functional medicine dives into that pretty deep. And we come up with a matrix. If you haven't seen our new matrix, it's really cool online, called the Living Matrix. And we go through all 7 of the functions specific to you and to your, to whatever your symptoms are, so that you can understand which dysfunction, which part of the 7 functions are really dysfunctional for you. And where do we start with that? That's what we understand as functional medicine practitioners, is where do we start with all of that? And the main place that we mostly start is the gut. And we start with the gut because it's like the fuel intake system for your whole car, right? If you don't have any intake for your fuel to your car, your fuel pump isn't working, or your gas tank has a hole in it, how well is your car gonna run? How well is this machine gonna run? It's gonna run like a 1962 leaky Buick, or is it gonna run like a 2018 Ferrari? Because that's what I want. So what do you think are some major energy drains? Energy creation is one of those seven functions. So what do you think are some of the major energy drains? Do you want to come up with a couple, or do you just want me to see? Stress. That's awesome. You're correct. Stress is a big drain. Mental, emotional stress, particularly.
Environmental toxins?
Another big one. Yep, because that also prevents, there's these little things inside our cells, they're like ComEd for your cell, and they're called mitochondria. Big word. Little function, huge function, little organelle, but they create all the energy in your body, and those toxins can clog up that mitochondria and poison it. Actually, antibiotics are one of the poisonous things for your mitochondria. So if you have a history of antibiotics from the get-go, right? Ear infections, particularly my 30-something crowd, that's like the amoxicillin crowd. They were throwing amoxicillin at the 30-somethings a few years ago like it was nothing. Like it was, oh, just take it, you're fine, just take it. And now we're seeing 30-somethings with some pretty outstanding gut issues. In where I would normally see them at 45, 50, I'm seeing them late 20s, early 30s, because of that rise in antibiotic use, or at least that's part of it, right? Chronic fatigue syndrome in teenagers. Right? Chronic fatigue syndrome in teenagers. I've had several over the past couple years, and I had none 10 years ago. Right? I mean, it was just didn't happen. Teenagers didn't get chronic fatigue. So the stress levels, the types of food that we're eating, the amount of environmental toxins are all energy drains, not keeping your blood sugar even. Totally can wipe out your energy stores and your ability to create energy well. So energy. What about foods that create inflammation? We hear a lot about inflammation, don't we? Inflammation is the root cause of everything. But is it really the root? We just talked about seven basic functions in the system. Inflammation isn't part of that. It's part of our defense and repair system. Inflammation is actually necessary. If we don't have inflammation, we can't heal. Right? Maybe you didn't really realize that. But inflammation gone wild creates pain, creates allergies, creates autoimmune disorders. Usually in some sort of order there. Big allergies, bigger autoimmune issues, problems with dealing with bacterial infections and viruses can also offset that system so that you can't heal well. And it drains the system, right? We can also have infections that drain our energy as well. We don't even know where they are. They can be up in our gums, hanging out in our gut, and we don't know they're really there until we're just at this place where everything hurts and we can't get out of bed and we feel like crap. So foods are one of the biggest pieces of information that our body gets. We get information from our eyes, our ears, our nose, our mouth, and the food we eat. And that food can either create health or create inflammation, and it's your choice. The foods that we know create inflammation is our standard American diet. The modern urban diet, you know, that spells mud. Standard American diet spells sad. So the sad mud diets out there are creating an America that is the most obese and most sick. We are the most obese and sick nation on the planet. We spend more money than anyone else, and we are still the most sick and obese nation. What's the deal? It's about our food. And most of our food isn't really food, right? It's devoid of nutrients, it's overprocessed. The move back to actually little farms, little gardens, and our terraces is really starting to take ground, because we're realizing that what we've been doing created this health crisis that we have now. The challenge is, and what we know is, that the medical system is set up to create and treat disease. They're not set up to create health or manage health. They're here to manage your disease when you have that acute problem. It's a disease management system. That's what your insurance is for, so that you don't die. That's what the RDA for vitamins is for, so you just don't die. It has nothing to do with creating health. Creating health is a whole different picture. And so our food and foods that create inflammation push onto that disease system. And our medical doctors aren't trained in nutrition. As it stands, and we've known this since 1990, and the research that I've done for the book, that they know in the medical community that they need to have nutrition. They've known it since the early 90s, and probably before that, but those were the studies I found. And nothing has changed. 25% of medical schools have 1 hour to a 1 month rotation in nutrition. Even if it changed today, somebody makes a decree tomorrow that all medical schools must have nutrition, the doctors that are in there now don't get out for another 10 years because of the way their medical system is. And they would have to change all of that machinery to add in functional medicine and nutrition. And it's not happening, right? Doctors are stuck in a triangle. That's their medical education at the top, the insurance companies, and themselves. And in the middle is the American Medical Association, and they can't get out. The minute they try to do what we do as chiropractors, they lose their licenses, they go to jail, they have their practices raided, because they are trying to do what's right and bring lifestyle medicine to their patients. The insurance companies keep all the stats. So they know, the insurance companies know how many prescriptions that doctor has given. And if they're out of balance, if they're an outlier, and they haven't given enough statins for the number of patients that they have, they become an outlier. And the insurance companies come down on them. And they get kicked out of the plans. And then what happens to them? So just understand that it's kind of a big conundrum out there. There are medical doctors that are saying, fine, I'm out. There's plenty of them, right? Dr. Mark Hyman, Dr. Amy Myers, just to mention a couple. And Dr. Isabella Wentz, she's a pharmacist who did the Hashimoto's thyroid book. But they're coming out. And they're also starting to tell the truth about what's happening. So it's a groundswell. You guys are at it. You're in it. I want you to be part of the revolution. That's functional medicine and what we do here. And I'm like leading the charge. I'll be right there on my white horse. So what's the deal with water? Right? We're all told, oh, we need to make sure we drink our water every day. What's the deal? Well, most of our body is water. So 80, depending on where you read, right? Okay, I have a student in the room. Lexi, tell me what's the percentage of water in the body?
Like 80 something, yeah. 20.
It's about 80%. So if 80% of your body is water and you don't exchange that water, what happens? right? You kind of become, I like to think about, I come from Florida, and so I think about it as a swamp. Can you picture like a Floridian swamp, right? Close your eyes, or a New Orleans swamp, right? Close your eyes, you got stuff hanging down into the swamp, and it's kind of green, and the crocodile's like in there, but you can't really see it because it's got all the green goo all over it, right? That's your swamp. So that's what happens to our body. We get toxins that build up in our system when we don't drink water. And then we wonder why we have a headache at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So dehydration is one of the most common things I find in our lab work. Yes, I understand people fast overnight, and so I give them a little bit of leeway. But if I see three or four markers that are saying dehydration, you're dehydrated. And you're more than dehydrated than just a day or a night. So that's something, water is really important. You can be a clear, spring-fed brook, right? You can imagine what that sounds like and what that looks like. Or you can be a Florida swamp. So your choice, drink your water. Half your weight in ounces every day. Half your weight in ounces every day. And do it however you need to, right? So I showed my cup to a patient the other day, and this is kind of, I have three of these. I have one in my car, I have one at home that sits usually by my bedside table, and I have one here. And she was like, oh my God, how many of those do I have to drink? I'm like, I don't know, three or four. They're 16 ounces, four-ish, you know, or more if you're exercising. And she's like, oh my gosh, I could never do that. I'm like, okay, whoa. What if we take it down to small bottles? Oh yeah, okay, that's much better. So everybody has to figure out what works for them. Some people carry around a gallon jug, and they just, like, that's their deal. I'm gonna get down this whole thing. But some people would just rather take it in smaller chips. Whatever it takes for you to get your water down, figure it out. Start with just doing micro habits, right? Okay, I'm gonna add a cup of water when I first get up, and a cup of water at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Just start there. Start adding it to a meal. If you connect a new habit to an old one, you have a much better chance of creating another new habit. It's like flossing and brushing your teeth. If you connect the two habits, you have a much greater chance of creating success. Exercise. So we all know that exercise burns calories, right? But what else does exercise do for us?
Mental health.
Bingo. So it's been shown in study after study after study that mild to moderate, right? This is like barely sweating exercise.
Yes.
Kristen's favorite kind of exercise. Mild to moderate exercise, 30 minutes a day, can equal some of the Prozacs, can be better than Zoloft, can be better than some of our antidepressants for mild to moderate depression. So move your body. It doesn't have to be sweaty. It just has to be moved, right? You can put on some fun music in your house where nobody's around. Go in your bathroom if your kids get cringy when you dance. Whatever. Move your body. My kids get so cringy when I dance. Oh, love! Don't! Oh, they'd be so embarrassed. So yes, happy chemistry, and you burn calories. I'm a big proponent of morning exercise because several reasons, actually. First of all, it's the only time that I don't have to do all this again. This doesn't happen by accident. I don't roll out of bed looking awesome. So I don't want to have to do it again. But so first thing in the morning, also your cortisol levels are higher at the beginning of your day. So you're probably going to naturally have a little bit more energy at the beginning of your day. And you can burn off any excess adrenaline that you might be feeling, anxiety or something, right at the beginning of your day. And so the rest of your day is much smoother. Also, starting to burn calories at that time of day, it gets your metabolism revved up and you stay revved up that way. Adding muscle mass. Right? Exercise, adding a little bit of muscle mass, particularly for women, is really important because our muscle mass is our metabolism. As our muscle mass diminishes, we have a harder and harder time maintaining our weight and maintaining energy and maintaining our glucose numbers because muscle tissue doesn't need insulin. And we'll talk about insulin and maintaining blood sugar in just a few minutes, but muscle tissue naturally just sucks in the glucose and burns it up. So the more muscle tissue that you can maintain or gain, the better off you're going to be. And guess what? It's never too late. So there's studies done on 70 and 80 year old wheelchair bound people, right? Sitting in their wheelchair, doing 5 pound weights. Guess what? They gain muscle mass. It doesn't take a lot. It just takes consistency, right? So exercise is a big deal. So we've talked a little bit about eat, drink, move. What about sleep? Yeah, I mean, I'll come real here. Sleep is where I struggle. I don't struggle with sleep, I struggle getting to bed. I struggle not getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning to just do this one more thing. I struggle with that. I'll go to bed at 10, but I'm up early because I want to do this thing or that thing, or I've got this thing rolling in my head. So I get my 6, most nights, but like that's my the habit that I struggle with the most is actually getting enough sleep. Why do we need sleep?
Repair.
Yeah, that's our repair time. That's like your car gets picked up by a ferry every night, it gets taken to the shop, and all the hoses and belts, and you open the engine, it looks disgusting. Everything gets steam clean, you got a little door ding, it gets all fixed. That's what happens to your body overnight. Like all the broken parts get fixed when we sleep. And if we miss sleep over time, what are we gonna do? What does that door look like after 10 years, right, of not getting sleep, not getting fixed? Lots of door dings, right? That's what happens to us too. We end up with little dings here and there. Right? That we'd like to have fixed. The more we sleep, the better sleep we can get, the better off that our repair system is going to work over time. I actually had to learn that the hard way. I had my kids when I was 40. Most of you know are right around 40. And before that, I was like, I'm good. I could go for days on 4 or 5 hours. No problem. I had kids and boom. I had no idea that I actually really needed 7 or 8 hours of sleep until I'd had a kid. So it was a big awakening for me and an understanding of who I am and an awareness of, oh my gosh, I really feel crappy today. How many days has it been since I actually got a decent night's sleep? Yeah. And why am I so crabby and why am I bitching with my kids? How much sleep have you had? Yeah, not enough. So it also impacts our moods, our anxiety levels. Anxiety is a big thing. But if you're not sleeping, your body can't repair your adrenals. It can't repair your brain. It can't work through. We know that our brains work overnight. We also know that when we sleep and we wake up, some of the things that bothered us yesterday are like, oh, that's a better perspective, right? But if you don't sleep enough, those perspectives don't get a chance to shift. And so you get mired in drama in your own head of stuff that may or may not be this real thing that's actually happening. It's just some stories that you start telling yourself or some untruths that you have created for yourself and limiting self-beliefs. And so sleep is really important to keep a good, healthy perspective on your life. So that's just a little, that's our tidbit about sleep is, you know, it's really necessary not just to repair and restore, but also to repair what happens up here for our mental health. So let's talk about crap. Where did this come from? So crap came out of I feel like crap, and I decided to turn it around. I was sitting with my favorite web guy who takes care of a lot of things for me. He's awesome. And he's like, really, let's figure out your acronym and then you can finish up your book. You'll have a place to hang the rest of your book. And I'm like, I don't know, this whole thing. And he's like, well, you know, he goes, what are the words in your world? I'm like, crap is the biggest word that I hear all the time. I eat crap. I feel like crap. He goes, okay, let's work on it. So we came up with clean it up, right? Clean it up. This is not a mystery to anyone that eating Doritos or Cheetos, things that are orange but aren't, shouldn't be orange, things that are blue that shouldn't, like, blueberries aren't blue, they're purple. Things that are colored blue aren't blueberry, right? Eating real, eating processed food is crap. It's this, the marketing that has, that's people spend billions and billions and billions of dollars on. Why do you think they have to spend that money? Because they need to convince you that it's healthy. Who doesn't know that fruits and vegetables are healthy? Like, how do you get out of the first grade and not know that? Right? We all know this. So, clean it up. Eat, drink, move, sleep, think and feel. We talked just a little bit about the think and feel piece. Once you clean it up, you're going to find that a lot of stuff kind of shakes out just by cleaning it up. But if not, we may need to restore function. Gut first, right? We need to make sure that our fuel system is cleaned up and good to go so that we're getting the nutrients that we need. Gut first, always. Even in patients, even for people who don't have gut issues coming in, right? There's a third of the population that has asymptomatic leaky gut. They have symptoms elsewhere and no gut symptoms, but it's still there. They have foggy brain, that's a gut issue. Maybe they don't have digestive complaints, but if your brain is foggy, your gut is leaky and your brain is leaky. It's the same thing. It's the same thing. So restore function, gut first, then probably liver, because that's the rest of the digestive system is liver. So liver needs to come second. We need to make sure that your liver is supported. And I'm not talking about a detox. I'm talking about supporting an organ system that already does detox. Like it already knows what it's supposed to do. It just needs the extra nutrients to do it. It already has the job. It already knows what to do. It's like the garbage man, right? He already knows what to do. He's just got to pick up the trash. He just needs the truck. So we're just going to make sure that you have the right truck and the right tires and that right big thing that comes and picks up your thing that does this, right? So we're going to make sure you have all the pieces, parts to make sure that your liver is working properly. And then we may need to look at hormonal balance or immune system a little bit deeper, depending on what you've got going on. Those are some of the things that we're going to, those are going to take a little bit deeper dive than just clean up the gut and support your liver function. So restore function, clean it up, restore function. What do you think all that takes? A little bit of action, right? What?
An attitude.
An attitude, I love that. Yes. That's awesome. That's really good.
It should be crap. Two A's.
No.
Action.
I totally got this. So my dad, I'm going to partially dedicate this to my dad. You haven't heard the story, but you reminded me. My dad, when he gets mad, now he was born in Boston, but raised in Chattanooga. So when he gets mad, he says, "Oh, crap!"
There you go.
So that's it. It's crap.
Attitude and action.
Attitude and action. Love that. So yeah, you got to put some action in your life, right? You actually have to do it. That's the hard part. It's actually kind of fun the first couple weeks. Like, ooh, I'm making this new recipe, and I've got this new, I don't know, blender or a bullet, or you know, you got this new thing. But 4 to 6 weeks down the road, two things happen. Maybe 8 weeks, right? Either you get really cocky. I'm doing good. I feel so much better. I got 7 pounds off of me now. 8 pounds are down. I'm feeling great. Yep, going to the Cubs game. I'm going to have a hot dog and a piece of pizza and a couple beers. Boom. It happens. It's okay. Like, there's no judgment about that. Like, we're human. We get it. But this is where the hard meets the action. And that's where coaching and texting and phone calls at 8:30 at night, and that's where we come in to really help support you. And what I want to create with my DIY piece of this A is an online community that can help come in and support you when I'm not around, right? You'll have a community. hopefully we'll also have a community, a personal community, at least here in Wheaton, and maybe elsewhere. Who knows? You know, on Facebook, for sure. Mm-hmm. P, this has to be personal. This has to be about you and you and you. It has to be about your person and you, right? It's about you. It's not about what your parents think. It's not about what your mom says is right for you. It's not about what your husband thinks or your boyfriend. It's about what you know intuitively is right for you and standing in it. It took me a long time to stand here and write the book after, you know, three tries. But I'm here and I wrote the book. And you guys can come together, make it personal, take it personal, and take it out and be the best person that you're supposed to be. You know, I think, and I'm gonna get a little philosophical, and I'll share a little bit of my piece of faith with you, but like, I think that we were put on this planet by God, or a bigger being, whatever that is to you, to play out a role here, and to do something, and we're all made uniquely perfect to do our perfect job, whatever that is. And part of life is discovering what that is. I've figured mine out. This is clearly where I need to be. So hopefully this is a piece of where you need to be too, and you can sing it out to the world. So welcome to cut the crap out of your life, out of your health, you know, cut the crap out of it, cut the crap out of your attitude, and take back your health. Thank you. Questions?
Yeah, should I keep going?
Nah. Bye, all.